Reporting out of closed session, it's a recommendation of the interim superintendent Stephanie Aiello that Paul Betts be appointed summer school principal, effective date to be determined. It was unanimous, 5-0, and motion made by Mrs. Smith, seconded by Ms. Vincent. Also reporting out of session is the recommendation of interim superintendent Stephanie Manello that Andy Cannon be appointed director of educational services, effective July 1, 2016. Motion made by Mrs. Smith, seconded by Mr. Ruling. It was 4-1 with Ms. Vincent opposed. Congratulations. I don't know if anybody's here.
It was Andy.
So with that, now we establish the quorum.
Good evening, Board Member Deborah Benson.
Present.
Board Member Fernando Navarro.
Here.
Board Member Claire Smith.
Here.
Board Vice President Walter Ruley.
Here.
Board President Diane Gibson Gray.
Here. If you all stand for the flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. We'll go to approval of board minutes for March 9th. What's the pleasure of the board?
Move approval.
I have a motion by Mrs. Smith.
Second.
Second by Mr. Ruley. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0. We move to superintendent report.
Well, first I want to introduce Chris Learned. He is our interim CBO, Chief Business Officer. He's been here a total of 11 days.
Really?
Doesn't seem much longer. It's been so rewarding and fulfilling that it seems like a very long time. But welcome. It's been a real pleasure having him. Mr. Learned is, thought he retired in June as a CBO of Ocalanus Unified School District. And prior, I think it was there for 18 years. And prior to that was in San Ramon for 21. So we welcome him. It's been an adventure. And then I am going to let Ms. Smith, for those of you who weren't here earlier, it's her news to tell. So
it's a reenactment.
It's a reenactment. Yes. Kind of like we did for Fernando when he missed his first swearing in public. Let him do it again. So I don't know if this will be easier or harder. I feel like I need to do this in a public board meeting. So this is the public meeting. They made me do it earlier for a lot of the staff that was here. So over the last, first of all, I'm the only board member left that has an odd number at the end of my term. And the reason for that is because the very first time that I ran for election, we were not a consolidated, we had our own independent election. Are you the only one in the room that remembers? Okay, so were you here then? Okay. By law, you cannot shorten your term. You can only extend your term. So when we consolidated to be during presidential and gubernatorial elections, those of us on the board at that time had an extra year thrown on. So my years were never 4, 8. They were always, 5, 9, or 13, or whatever. I was always, that's why I'm at 21 and not 20 like you would expect. So those 21 years, ironically, I have served with 21 different members and 6 different superintendents. Kind of a lot of people to get to know. And so when I ran the last time, my husband had a heart attack a week after the election. At that time, we decided that our life was going to take a different turn. And he immediately retired and was allowed to be my best friend again that I spend 24/7 with and I never get sick of him. And I remembered how much I enjoyed being with him before we worked together before we moved up here in our own business and I was with him 24/7. And so I had gotten over the years of raising all these kids that everybody in this district knows quite well. Let's see, who would they know the best? Oh, probably Michael. Yes? Is that fair? So when the heart attack happened and he retired, we determined then that I was not going to run again for another term on the board. So that was kind of a foregone conclusion. Then last year on my birthday, my oldest daughter decided she was going to move south. So she left. And ever since then, I have going back and forth to Southern California at least once a month. And finally, at Christmas time, she said, Mom, it's costing you a fortune, just, you know, all trips back and forth, flying or driving or whatever. And so on January 18th, all six of my kids surprised me and came home and totally cleaned out the house. I mean, everything, pictures off the walls, everything boxed, put in the garage, and we listed our house for sale, and it sold within 2 weeks. And so we are now moving to a new adventure down by our grandchildren, and our other son is moving to a 3.5-hour drive away, and we're just super excited to be moving on. Our daughter, our oldest daughter, is kind of a more public figure than I've ever been. She and her family do a YouTube channel called Family Fun Pack. They are number 3 in the world. And because of that, her children that are ages 9 and under are very well known. If we go anywhere in public, people know who they are. And she gets very concerned about that. And so we have a new dog. It's called Nanny and Papa Buddy. So whenever we go anywhere, one of the little kids will have either Nanny or Papa as their buddy, and it's just another layer of her protection that she wants to have for her kids. And we hate doing that, right, honey? So we are actually moving. Tonight will be my last board meeting. And I purposefully did not real public with this because we are in transition a lot, and I want to be very respectful of that. And I tried not to make you have to do an appointment, but the stars aligned so perfectly that it's just meant to be. It always has been. Anybody who knows me knows that the only reason I ever ran the first time is because I just felt that it's what God wanted me to do. And I've always felt that way. That has never changed. And we both feel very strongly that these stars aligned at this time because it's what God wants us to do again. And so we are moving forward with that, and we're really excited. I'm really sorry to have to leave some people here. Unlike a previous board member who left here with a lot of anger, I have nothing but respect and admiration for the 21 board members that I've served with. I believe with all my heart that I have learned from them, and they have made me a better person, and I will be able to take that with me into my next life. And I have enjoyed working with members of staff who have also been very respectful to myself. I've appreciated the love and kindness that they have shown to my family over the years. Some of them have been very influential on my children. Some of them aren't in the room right now, but I just want to pick on Scott Burger House because I like to. I tell everybody Scott's my little brother because when Stephen and Laura went to middle school, he took a real special interest in Stephen and kind of changed Stephen's attitude about a lot of things. And when Stephen found out that he went to school in southern Utah, we went to visit grandparents that happened to live in St. George, and he found a red rock and brought it home for Mr. Burger House. Some reason that red rock was everything Mr. Burger House was. For some reason, it just... So, Scott, you'll always be my little brother. So tell Mom I'm still going to watch out for you. And there's just a lot of people in the district that I really like. I just want to say how grateful I am to this board and to you as individuals. No one but me can say this to you because no one out here really knows, except maybe my husband and my kids, how much time and effort this takes. And so I just want to thank you for putting yourself out there and running to begin with, stating your position and representing people of Antioch and the children of Antioch. And I just want you to know that if anybody were ever to ask me anything about this district and this board, I would have nothing but good things to say about each and every one of you. Some of you I don't know quite as well, Fernando. But I still have a lot of respect for the things that you're doing. And you have a lot to do. And, you know, I have complete trust and faith in your ability to pick an awesome superintendent and of the other positions that will be available. I have complete confidence in your ability to do that and to pick another board member, albeit temporary, and they may get, you know, unvoted in, but that's the way life is. So, yeah, thank you all. I'm going to miss certain people a lot. Nancy is probably the best assistant ever. She takes complete care of the board. All you have to do is suggest something, and it's like taken care of. CSBA registration, done. The day it opens, she always gets us the best parking spaces and the best everything. Stephanie, you stepped up to the plate, and you did what I knew you could do. I have had confidence in you for a very long time, and I'm really proud of where you've come, and I know you're a rising star. And Bob, I'm going to miss you because you always give me hugs. And Chris, you know I begged to have you come back. And even though you're not part of the whole district, I have always respected you and your ability to present to a board. And then that's why when you were available, I was just like, get her. And when Jessica said, I know her. I'm like, yes. So Jessica, thank you for bringing a fresh breath into the HR department. Sorry, I don't know anything about you. You're on your own tonight. You have a nice tie. If I didn't call you by my name, it doesn't mean that I don't love you. It's just that they'll probably hit me with something if I keep talking. So anyway, I do want to show you this.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, this is so beautiful. You'd think my husband made it. It's so beautiful. But it's from. It's from the board thanking me. And then earlier I opened certificates from the elected officials that are representing our district, which was very nice. So,
yes, she received proclamations from Congressman Nerney, Senator Glazier, Congressman Desaigne,
Mary Pifo,
Glazer, whatever, all those people.
And Contra Costa County Board of Education, or whatever they are.
For 21 years. So with that, did anybody have any words they wanted to say to Claire?
So I will say thank you for all the desserts, Claire. Helped us add on a couple of pounds. And thank you for your services to the district. This is a very challenging seat to sit in, and it requires a lot of professionalism and collaboration. And Claire has been, you know, I remember when my daughter was in Park and Mr. Burgerhouse would announce a school board member, and it was always Claire. So thank you for your service to this district, and I do know that people will miss you.
Thank you.
I'd like to add that you've helped me a lot. You've taken it under your wing, and it's a steep learning curve. Mm-hmm. I've learned a lot the last couple of months and haven't had the privilege to know you as much as a lot of people on board, but I thank you for your service, and the more I'm learning of this position, the more I know that it takes a lot of dedication. It's not well paid, but you get paid in monetarily in another system upstairs.
You won't be the new guy for much longer.
Nope.
And let me tell you, here's the best paycheck I ever received on this board. I think this is my favorite. One student that I've known since kindergarten was with my kids, graduated from Antioch High School. That year they had given them white roses. He came up to me, he gave me the white rose, and he said, I will never forget you. And he gave me a big, huge hug. Mm-hmm. About 6 years later, he saw me at a Boy Scout activity, and he said, hi, Mrs. Smith, do you remember me? And I said, yes, I do. And he said, I just graduated with my bachelor's in marine biology. Wow. And it was just like, yes! So that was sweet. That's your pay.
Don't play up the record. I'm going to miss you. 21 years, to put that in perspective, 21 years of service. I've served, I'm going to my 10th year now. And that seems such a long time. So 21, it's amazing. Actually, Claire, to my understanding, has the longest tenure of any school board trustee in the history of Antioch. And probably the longest service in community service, elected office, for any one particular office. Now, Mary Rocha has held office for 35, 36 years, something like that. But that's been mayor.
16 years on the school board.
School board, city council. So 21 years in one office. Quite amazing. I'll remember Claire for being authentic. News reporter today, the Times asked me about tonight and said, what is it about Claire? I said, she's one of a kind. Don't always agree in style, sometimes in substance, on the boats. And then again, I don't agree with the wife and everything. That's what makes the world go around. So in New York, where I come from, they would call Claire Mensch. Just a real authentic person. What you see is what you get. Fun, brings a lot of good humor to what can sometimes be a, I wouldn't say a depressing business, but it can have its moments. She's our historian, knows schools and the players and the issues inside out. But Claire is that theory. Claire has been there. I mean, she's been there, she's read the textbooks. She's got the dirt under her nails. I mean, she's lived this. You talk about school calendars or any issue. And that's one of the amazing things about the school business is just when you think you know a little bit, you realize how little you know. There is so much. You could spend your whole life just studying transportation or curriculum or the nutrition side of the school business. It's that and the other thing. Claire knows a lot. And last but not least, got a lot of integrity, a lot of guts. Now, I may have lost count somewhere along the line, but I believe that the three superintendents, probably the time came, we'll just put nicely, the time came where maybe it was best for them to move on. That's not easy. The easy way to do it as a school board trustee is just to ignore it and let it go on and go on. Claire's always had the guts when she's seen the situation where she thinks the clock has run out, maybe a superintendent's kind of run out of gas. Claire hasn't been afraid to be there and see, you know, for the good of the kids. It's time. That takes a lot of guts. So she hasn't always done the easy thing, but she's done the right thing. So we'll miss her. But life goes on.
And I will repeat the story that I said at 4:15 when I ran 7.3 years ago. If you had told me that I would be in alignment with Claire on many of the issues, I would have said, wouldn't they fly? And apparently they're flying around Antioch because we have been on the same side of a lot of things. And it's all about the kids. So the focus is on the kids. Claire's focus has always been the kids. And I didn't realize that would make us have a common bond. Yeah, pigs are flying. So anyway, with that, we'd just like to wish you the best. Deborah wants to lead a standing up. And your husband did fill out a form, but I'm going to let him come ahead. You want to say something to Claire?
You know what? I do want to acknowledge my family because they have been behind me 100%, and it hasn't always been easy. And tonight, Angela's here with me. She's one of the triplets. And Stephen is here with me. He's one of the twins. And with him is his fiancée, Shannon. And of course, Laura's at school, Michael's in the academy, Christine's doing her family fun pack thing. So you can follow me on Family Fun Pack, okay? Because that's where I'm going to be from now on. You can see us there. But I do appreciate my family and my adorably cute husband.
So, Craig Smith, adorably cute husband, please come forward. I can't believe I had to say those words.
I guess that's me. I did want to say a few things about my dear and wonderful wife and school board member, president. She's done some incredible things over the years, as has been indicated here, and the things that she said. We haven't done anything in this city except that we have involved a lot of prayer and really deep thought and meditation about those decisions. And she's come to me more than once and asked for guidance and some issues. And I said, well, you know, it's the Lord. He's the one that's going to tell us what we need to do. And I think that has been the hallmark of this school district, is that the final decisions that have been made here have been made with those thoughts in mind. What really would he want us to do for the betterment of the students in this district? Because when you follow that as your basic tenet and guideline, you can't go wrong. He knows the best. He knows what we need. I want my wife to know that I truly have appreciated all the work that she's done. We've appreciated her and all the hours. I mean, some of these meetings used to go till 3 o'clock in the morning. And I know that it was hard on her. She didn't know that her husband was home worrying about her. I just pretended I was asleep. And she would come home, and I just had a great relief and was grateful. But I knew that she was doing an important and a great work here. Some of you don't know that Clara has a lot of other incredible talents. She has a beautiful singing voice. And then she and I have sung in choirs up and down the state and throughout the Western United States in different organizations. And this last weekend, we were able to perform an oratorio at the Santa Clara College, Catholic College. We're not Catholic, but we sing in all different venues. We sang the Lamb of God. It was an incredible performance that I know every person in that room felt touched by the music that we were able to perform there with. It was choir and soloists and a powerful orchestra, and it was a great, great experience for us. And unfortunately, it might be our last in this area, but we had a great time there. One that won't be forgotten, as well as everything that's happened here in this city. You're all special people.
Thank you. Best of luck taking your move. So with that, we'll move on to our regular scheduled agenda. Julie Young, I didn't see this until just now. You want to talk on the minutes?
Is it Julia,
I know, but you can go ahead and say whatever you wanted. I just now got it. I apologize.
The only thing I wanted to say was all of a sudden in the board minutes now, you guys are putting a board member said instead of each individual person. And I know at the last board meeting, Deborah had some concerns about something that she said in the minutes the previous time. So I didn't know why all of a sudden it says a board member. It doesn't say Claire said this or Walter said this. And I think that's you don't know who's saying who.
We don't usually respond at this time, but an easy answer to that one is that if you recall, the policy was changed on how we take minutes, and we're now following what's called action minutes. It's the recommendation of the California School Boards Association.
Okay, so then we'll never know who said what unless we listen to the recordings.
I know you will always know because you will have been here, but
I know what we know.
I don't remember every statement that everybody makes,
and sometimes I go back to the minutes because I'm like, I think that, you know, Deborah said this, and let me go back because I think, and I have gone back to some of the minutes to to look at that. And if I go back and it just says a board member, then I have to decipher based on personality what I think you guys said. So I think that's less transparent. And last time we were talking about transparency by having it videotaped, and now you're taking out the names. It's like less transparency. That's just my two cents.
Okay, Julie, on a different subject.
Yes.
You have to sit down to Julie.
And Mr.
Since I won't see you again, I think this is for Madeline.
Will you be doing a 3-minute?
It's a Civil War book that I promised I would let her read when I was done with it on the Battle of Gettysburg. So would you please give that to her with my best?
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry I missed you. Next, we'll go to student delegates. I'll wait for them
to go.
Okay.
Good evening, Board of Education and members of the community. My name is Alejandra Domingo, and I am here representing Deer Valley School. On Friday, March 11th, Deer Valley Squad of Senior Girls took on annual seniors at Elf Stadium in our annual Powerpuff competition. It was a very hard-fought game, and this year, DV emerged victorious with a final score of 15-8. It was an amazing night, and both teams are to be commended on their sportsmanlike conduct. We are looking forward to next year. March 14th through 19th was Multicultural Week at Deer Valley. Our student body enjoyed lunchtime demonstrations, presentations, and entertainment with cuisine for the many of the cultural clubs on campus. Clubs participating were the Polynesian Club, Japanese Culture Club, French Club, and Italian Club, and Hispanic neighbors. On Saturday, March 19th, we held our annual junior prom in the South Gym. The theme was a night in New York City, and all attendees had a fabulous time. We would also like to congratulate Ryan McKenna and Jose Trujillo on being put on this year's junior prom Prince and Princess. Deer Valley is one of 24 recipients in the state to receive a $1,200 grant to start a sustainable community garden. The 20 of which will be cross-curricular and nature with science, special education, and after-school programs participating. The garden at Deer Valley will focus on raising fruits and vegetables. A special thank goes out to staff member Mr. Andrew Wilson, an avid gardener himself, for writing the grant. Deer Valley hosted a WASP visiting team on campus from Sunday, February 29th through Tuesday, March 2nd, as part of our accreditation process. The visiting team had many positive things to say, commending our community for creating a college-going campus, supporting small rank communities and academies, increasing the number of counselors on campus, and the active inclusion of students and parents in the WASC process, among other things. We hope to receive our accreditation term sometime this summer. Renaissance Awards for the fall of 2015 semester were given out last week in February, and an impressive 42.5% of student body earned a GPA of 3.0 or higher during the fall of 2015. Students received chocolate, pizza, Jamba Juice, and vinegar certificates to recognize their achievement. We are very proud of our students. Congratulations go out to Deer Valley's men's varsity soccer team. As a result of hard work in the classroom, the team was awarded a California Interscholastic Federation North Coast Section Distinguished Scholastic Team Certificate with an overall team GPA of 3.33. In addition, 9 of the 18 varsity players had a GPA of 3.5 or higher. Congratulations to the Coach Tanis and the entire team. On Saturday, March 19th, at the CMEA Arts Ensemble Festival hosted at Deer Valley, both DV's orchestra and the symphonic band earned their composite superior rating and performance, and the orchestra also received a superior rating and sight reading. Congratulations to all of the students who participated and represented Deer Valley so well. Deer Valley continues to make progress in the areas of attendance and suspension rates. Our attendance rate has remained steady at over 95.6%, and our suspension occurrences are down 7.3 from last year. These changes are attributed to the introduction of restorative justice, peer mediation, and positive behavior intervention and support programs on our campus. On March 17th, 18th, and 19th, students from the ACE Academy and other science students participated in the Contra Costa County STEM Fair, which was held at Los Milagros College in Pittsburgh. 11 Deer Valley students submitted science research projects in a wide array of disciplines, including psychology, aerodynamics, physical science, computer science, engineering, and biological science. Deer Valley took home two second place awards, two third place awards, and several special awards. Congratulations to the outstanding students. The Deer Valley of Performing Arts is proud to present a global musical based on the works of Dr. Seuss. This is wonderful entertaining show will be staged on April 15th, 16th, 22nd, and 23rd at 8 p.m. on April 16th and 23rd at 2 p.m. at the Deer Valley Theater. Tickets are available online at therapper.seatyourself.biz or at the door. Some upcoming events and important dates that we'd love everyone to attend are the DE Foundation Gala Dinner at the Lone Tree Golf Course in the Event Center on April 9th. Our Spring Rally, which is on April 15th, the DeVapa Susical Musical at our Deer Valley Theater on April 15th, 16th, 22nd, and 23rd. A Senior Ball at the Scottish Rite Center in Oakland on May 7th. Our DV Awards Night on May 9th, and our DV Scholarship Night on May 16th. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just want you to know I was a judge at the fair. I was very proud of Deer Valley students. Please tell them.
Good evening, Board of Education and members of the community. My name is Jordan Colcord, and I'm here representing all three alternate ed sites of Prospects, Bidwell, and iVote. At Prospects, we are gearing up for our fourth annual college and career fair on Wednesday, April 13th, from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. in Prospects atrium. We invite the board to stop and visit. We will have three guest speakers from LMC, DDC, and our own Mr. Daniel Reyes of AESD, who will share with our students about the security management industry pathway and opportunities it provides for various careers. We are very excited about our upcoming fair. In April, we will have a College Career Week starting on Monday, April 11th through Friday, April 15th. Staffs and students will be encouraged to wear college gear and attire, and our campus will be decorated with college and mascot posters and pins. On April 20th, leadership students and seniors will be doing campus beautification from 2-3 p.m. to around the campus. And it's also near by buildings we are located by the very transient population who are homeless. We want to give back to the community and also help take care of our school appearance, having pride and taking ownership. On April 26th, we will have a superhero day. Staff and students will dress as their favorite superheroes. As SBAC testing approaches our for our district, students and staff are preparing and ramping up for the assessment period and are ensuring that all materials and test proctors are secured and ready for a successful testing trial. Encore, our home school program, has carried a theme throughout the year in the various student activities known as the Time Machine. In support of this theme, students of the Engineer Club built their own Da Vinci clocks as a newest project. Recently, Encore held their Inventors Convention, where students designed, created, and presented their own unique inventions using this scientific method. The Photography Club is putting together a visual presentation for the upcoming April 22nd art show. Students' work will be on display in our atrium from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. In addition, students of Encore are completing research on one of their favorite heroes from history and will give an oral presentation in April. We continue to graduate students and are very proud of their hard work and academic success. In conclusion, on Thursday, March 10th, at the annual EXA Awards Dinner, our very own principal, Dr. Ben Clark, received the Alternate Education Administrator of the Year Award, being honored and recognized. Prospect staff and students would like to say congratulations again on this prestigious award, Dr. Clark. At Bidwell, they completed their WASC self-study visit on Tuesday, March 1st. The WASC listening team arrived on Sunday, February 28th. They were greeted by our principal, Carol Lillard, and Wellness Coordinator and Resource Teacher, Michelle Thompson. The team toured the campus and later met with Bidwell Leadership Team and the District Office Representative, Mike Santos, and several parents. The Wellness Visiting Community was a 14-member, chaired by Jeff Dole, a program consultant from the California Department of Education. Third quarter ended on Wednesday, March 17th, and seven seniors completed their graduation requirement. To date, the Bidwell has had 21 graduates for the 2015-2016 school year. While at Vicar High School, WASC Miss Cycle Review was held on February 22nd and 23rd. Open House was well attended by parents and guardians. Live Oak had 11 graduates this quarter and 20 new students entering for the fourth quarter. Plans are underway for Live Oak's Community Awareness Day being held in May. Lastly, Live Oak held at the Blood Drive on March 15th. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Everybody staying? Okay, that's good. Okay, so now we'll move into public comments. If anybody else has one that you haven't turned in, please turn it in to me. We're starting this session at 7:40. We'll do 30 minutes. If we're not done, we'll move to item 26. I think we'll finish just looking at the numbers here. So we'll start out with John Crowder, followed by Jill Young.
Good evening. The reason I wanted to speak tonight is I was also at the Contra Costa County Science and Engineering Fair this Friday as a judge. And again on Saturday, was able to go back and see some of the students and look over some of the projects. And I wanted to come talk to you and really commend a couple of people, a couple of your teachers, and also some other people that participated in these projects. This is an Intel-affiliated science and engineering fair, which is a pretty big deal. The students that win Best in Show go on to the International Intel Competition, which is participated in by entries from over 68 countries around the world. The grand prize winner at that competition is an $80,000 scholarship. So I wanted to recognize first the students, and as was already mentioned by one of the student delegates, you had several student entries. And then I also wanted to mention a couple of other residents at Antioch who were there judging the science fair. One was Ms. Vincent, who took the time all day Friday to be at the science fair acting as a judge, and the other was Ms. Joy Motz. And it was very nice to see some other people in Antioch there encouraging these young students in their science endeavors. And then finally, I really wanted to commend two really outstanding teachers in the district, and that is Rick Barton of Antioch High School, who was able to get encourage multiple students' entries in the environmental category. And then also Jeff Adkins from BHS, who was able to get students to participate in behavioral science entries, biological science, engineering, math, computer science, and physical science. This is a lot of work for the students who typically do all this work after school hours. And it's also quite a bit of work for teachers that are going to take their own time to help encourage these students to go succeed in the STEM type careers in the future. So I just wanted to come before you and let you know about these people that did this outstanding work. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Torres, would you open up that back door, please? It's awfully warm here. You don't have anything until, I believe, 17 years later. Okay. Julie Young is next. You're Julia, right?
Yes.
She's Julia. Okay.
Good evening, board members. So I just wanted to come and tell you about the superintendent meeting that I attended on Monday, March 14th at the Antioch Water Park. And so we met with these people, leadership associates, and there were quite a few people at the meeting. And so what I guess I'm concerned about is at the beginning they introduced themselves and told us a little bit about what they were doing to find our superintendent. And it sounds like just putting the advertisement out on a few websites, the education websites and stuff, often from coming to the board meetings and hearing what you guys wanted, it sounded like you guys wanted them to proactively go out and try and find, you know, people. And it didn't sound like they were really doing that. It sounds like they're just sitting back and waiting for the applicants to come in. They had us all talk about, you know, what we felt Antioch needed and things like that. And of course, there's also, because we have such a diverse community, there's a lot of, you know, things going on there. They also said that your main focus for the superintendent was to focus on curriculum. I found that concerning, or not really concerning, but I like, what did that have to do with the superintendent's job, that they would focus primarily on curriculum and that's what you guys were trying to find a superintendent to focus on curriculum, when we have this stupid Common Core stuff put out by the federal government and the state of California, and you have to follow that curriculum anyway? It's not like you guys can go out and change it. So those were some of my concerns about that superintendent meeting. I'm just hoping that maybe you guys will take this feedback back to them and say, are you really going out and looking more than just having people come to the website and apply, and then just going straight into the whole education arena only? And so those are my concerns.
Thank you. I can tell you, having worked with leadership associates in the past, they're not going to tell you who they're looking for. When they go out and find someone, it's very confidential. They could have talked to any number of people currently in a position, but they're not going to tell you, oh yeah, we're over looking at the superintendent from this district or that district.
Oh,
it's all going to be...
No, I didn't expect them to tell us who they were looking for. It seemed like they were only focusing on the education thing, and when they were talking, it just sounded like they were waiting for applicants to come to them instead of them being proactive. That's how it sounded.
They are proactive.
Okay.
Very proactive.
Okay. Okay, next is Joshua Klee, followed by Velma Wilson.
Good evening. I was going to tell you about an experience that I had at Dallas Ranch Middle School last Friday. I've been hearing a lot of complaints as far as behavior and disruptions in the classroom, and it became so apparent that I needed to make an appearance at the school. I talked to the math teacher, Mrs. Gladden, beforehand, and told me to please come down and sit down and see what we actually go through on a daily basis. I sat from first period to seventh period, and during every class except for maybe one class, there was disruptions throughout the day. There was kids just coming in from other disruptive classes, just coming and sitting down with in the classroom. And teacher would say, what are you guys doing here? And she said, oh, my teacher sent me here. So 5 minutes goes by, I have to sit, I have to find a place for this student to sit, becomes disruptive. 10 minutes later, that same student raises a hand, hey, I want to go back to my class. Disrupts the class again. Throughout the, I think it were 45-minute period sessions, they maybe had 10 minutes of learning time where they weren't telling a kid to stop messing around, asking a child to move. It became apparent that the teacher needed to set some ground rules as well. So it wasn't just teachers, it wasn't just a student, it's a combination. But her reasoning for trying to deal with the problems they arise was that every time she sends a referral or does something disciplinary, she has to answer to those things. And every time she's had a principal tell her what to do, he said, well, what can you do better? What can you do to change the situation? So she just got tired of doing that whole process and just deals with it every day. This teacher had been attacked before. That same student was told, well, we're just going to move from some period to first period, but the same teacher. So very productive there. Like I said, finding a lot of things and seeing a lot of things that I've seen during this time period was very eye-opening. And I would invite you guys to come in unannounced and try sitting through some of these classes that you hear so much about.
Thank you very much.
And I had one other thing. So see if you can answer this question. It's my daughter's homework today. She's in third grade.
Okay, you got 40 seconds.
Yeah, it'll be quick. Three more than 14A divided into two equal groups is E. She's in third grade. I've taken this to several people, and they say you can't put it into equal parts. It would be 8.5. No, you have to do this whole reasoning and whole rearranging to find out the equations. Well, like I said, child's in third grade. This is ridiculous. Principal, no. Teacher had to look up in the textbook to find the answer. And supposedly there's some whole rearranging with the verbiage. You have to actually read through the whole thing. But it's ridiculous. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I don't understand anything you said. That's all. I'm glad you came and shared that information. Out of curiosity, why did you just pick the math teacher?
Because throughout the whole year since it started, that seems to be my son's issue with disruptive behavior in that classroom from other students. Yeah, so they told me, and I even talked to other teachers while I was there in between periods. They come over and say, hey, who are you? And they don't know who I am. Shake their hand, talk to them a little bit. And they said, yeah, stick around for seventh period every day. I was like, yeah, the kids aren't so bad, second, third, fourth period. But first period, yeah, seventh period, you can see what the problems were. And a lot of those kids that actually caused the problems weren't even there that day. So, but
your son hasn't said too much about other classes?
He says some here and there, but this is the one where most of the destructive behavior comes from. And I used to talk to a student. She came up to me in between periods, and I said, oh, my God, this class has never been so easy. People have been behaving. Thank you. Please come here every day.
Would you mind giving your contact information to Ms. Williams? We'd like to help resolve the issue.
Thank you. Velma Wilson?
Thanks.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Okay, I'm going to be chipper because I'm normally chipper. Good evening. Coupons almost spring break. Y'all get a week off. But I just wanted to announce there's a couple of events. And some of you may know, some of you that don't know, I am the new president of the Antioch Schools Education Foundation, and it is this time of year when we start looking for our nominees for the Mary Ellen Fellows. Now, I am very competitive, so I expect to see those numbers be exponential because we really do have some wonderful teachers that really work hard with our students. Some may disagree, but I'm like, if you're not in those classrooms helping, then I want to hear it. So I will say we are looking for nominations for Mary Ellen Fellows. That event is coming up, and the nominations are going to be coming up to a close really soon. Also, I was just notified just shortly before I got here that Clarissa Wilson, yes, that's my daughter, has just moved to the second level for National Suboptimist International Violet Richardson Award. For those that don't know, Google it. You will see that as a huge honor. She is a freshman at Antioch High School. She is the first freshman to receive it here on the local level, and they called her to compete, and she was just advanced to the national level, and I just was notified that today. So on April 15th, they will be doing that honor, and there are several other recipients in the Antioch region that will be receiving other Suboptimist awards on April 15th at Lone Tree Golf Course. Those tickets are still available, but we just need to support our students when they're doing something good and positive and making impacts in the community. There's so many things that our kids could be doing. There's so many things that they could be getting into. Let's really affect our atmosphere, the positive nature of what our students are doing, not just because it's my child, but just any other child that I see so often. I see so many kids doing some things that are wonderful in this district that we need to affect. So those that want to affect the atmosphere with the negative posts or the negative videos of what may go on the campus, start affecting the things that are going on that are positive, and then let's see how the transition will change for the better for the overall community. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
And congratulations. for that.
Yeah.
Next, we go to individuals to address the board for items not on the agenda from the district employees. I have one. I think we could make it in the 30 minutes. Robert Strickler.
Might take 35.
Good evening, President Gibson Gray, Vice President Walter Rulig, board members Deborah Vinson, Fernando Navarro, and Claire Smith. Well, first I'll kind of go to, hopefully I'll have enough time. Claire, thank you for all that you've done for students of Antioch. 21 years, that's an amazing career on a board. So thank you for all the good things that you've done. I really appreciate it. And thank you, and I guess your daughter will have to listen. This is one that made the cupcakes. Yeah. Thank you for wonderful cupcakes.
My assistant in the class.
But thank you very much. Anyway, first, I would like to say that we met with AEA, met with the superintendent interview committee last Tuesday. I would say they think did a great job. And I'd just like to share some of the things that we mentioned with them to give you a perspective on what we're looking for in a superintendent, even though I'm sure that they'll share that with you anyway. Teachers are looking for a superintendent that will make safety in our schools a priority, one that will support and back administration in dealing with the unsafe issues at their school sites. We need a superintendent that understands the needs of all our students, one that is able to meet the diverse needs of the students in Antioch. We're seeking a superintendent who values the opinion and input of all stakeholders in AUSD. We want someone who has a vision for technology, someone who will seek funding for a one-to-one technology for students. And finally, see if I can embarrass her. We believe a very strong candidate is Stephanie Anello. The teachers and the employees of AUSD have worked with her as a teacher. We worked with her as a site administrator. We worked with her as a district office administrator. She is approachable. These are not quite as red as your jacket, but they're bigger. She's approachable, reasonable, and listens to all sides. She's a person of action and decisive. She cares about the employees and students of AUSD. We believe she is a perfect fit for AUSD and has already proved that in her position as a assistant superintendent in educational services and the current interim superintendent. And I've said this before she's in this position. What I appreciate about her the most is she is a doer. I've come to her many a time, and she would call me that same day or email, taken care of, done, dealt with that. And I very much appreciate you. And I hope you get the position. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we move on to district reports.
Good.
Okay. Yeah, you have to give one. Okay.
I'll get my check later,
Goodness. Yes, we do have a district report. Sorry. It is, as you'll recall, there was an item for discussion by the board a couple of weeks ago. They wanted to know more about our safety preparedness plan, emergency preparedness plan. So this evening, I've asked Jeff Collins, who is coordinator of maintenance and operations, and also Daniel Torres. And Daniel, I'm so sorry. Bob's going to introduce your title. It just left the building. Supervisor of Site Safety there.
Emergency preparedness.
No, written down. Sorry.
Okay.
Good evening,
board.
Bob Sanchez.
Good evening, board president. Diane Gibson Gray, board vice president Walter Rulig, board trustee Ms. Vincent.
I want to
do the one last one, and board member Fernando Navarro and Claire. How to say that. So we are here just to give a brief oversight of what we do as far as emergency preparedness in our district. We know it's very, very important to protect the safety of all of the staff members and the students in our district. And the more we can train and drill, the better we will be. We hope we never have to use some of this stuff, but we want to be prepared. So we continue to update and train on our administrators on disaster preparedness and evacuation procedures. Board members, we will invite you to some of the trainings if you desire to attend. We have two online trainings that we're reviewing right now through Keenan and Associates, which is now called Target Solutions. One of the courses is disaster preparedness. It's an hour long. It's an online course. It has 11 modules. The other one is evacuation and emergency course, which is 7 modules long, and both of these courses have an end of the course exam. If they fit our needs, then we're going to offer those to all of our employees. We'll train new teachers at their orientation. We're going to add, at a suggestion of Ms. Vinson, the parent guardian emergency information guide to our student handbook, so our parents will have that when they pick up their student handbook. Thank God we've hired the district nurse, and she works under me, and she is now conducting an audit of all schools to identify students who may need medication and or assistance in the event of an emergency or evacuation. The list of the students and their needs will be included in the school safety plan. Staff members will be assigned to help each one of the students who will require assistance in the case of an evacuation. So that's going to be a definite integral part of our safety plans. So I'm going to turn it over to Jeff Collins, who's going to speak about the emergency plan, and then he will turn it over to Daniel Torres, who's supervisor of site safety and emergency preparedness. Thank you.
Good evening, members of the board. I'm Jeff Collins, and I want to do a quick overview of the emergency plan. The training that Bob referred to is in support of the very comprehensive plan that the district has developed through consultation with consultants over the years, and we feel that the plan is effective in delivering a product that it will support the needs of the district, the students, and staff in the event of a natural or human-caused emergency. I look real good at this thing. Again, basically the plan overview is that it provides an organized effort to address the district's need in the event of a natural or human-caused emergency. The plan relies on staff within the district to meet the objectives, and those objectives are to protect the safety and welfare of students, employees, and staff, to provide safe and coordinated response to emergencies, to protect the district's facilities and property so that we can rapidly restore normal operations to the district. I won't go through the rest of the bullet points here, but they all are in support of our goal, again, to ensure the safety of student, staff, and the public, and to restore normal operations to the district as quickly as possible. This is accomplished through various organizations. At the district level, we have the EOC, which takes place in this room, which manages and coordinates the response from the district level. In coordination or cooperation with district staff and the EOC, we have the FOC, which is the Facilities Operations Center, which will be headquartered at the annex across the street from Antioch High School, and we will primarily address the physical plant needs. We'll also support any transportation needs that may be directly needed by the district or through a mutual aid agreement with the surrounding districts, county, or the city. At the site level, each site also has an emergency plan, which is staff, and I apologize, it's difficult to see these. I think it's time we get a new projector in here and we're working on that. But the site has a very similar staff organization to the district, and they are charged with the safety, obviously, of the students and ensuring that those students are protected while they're at the campus and also leave the campus in an organized fashion as they're turned over to the parents. Sites are also responsible for special needs children, or because I'm a parent of special needs, those children with special qualities. Each site is charged with ensuring that those students' needs are met in the event of an emergency, and that's a very coordinated effort by the sites. And I've seen that in action, not here, but in another school district, and it's proved very effective. So with that, that is our emergency plan. I believe you were provided with the link to the comprehensive plan, which is on the web. I would invite you to look over it. It is very in-depth. In addition to that, there is an overview of the plan that's available to the public that shows the highlights of the emergency plan. And one of the things that's critical in an emergency plan is that you not share all the in-depth details, because you don't necessarily want to invite opportunities for those people that you don't want on campus to have information that may assist them. So again, the overview is available to the public on the website. And with that, I'll turn it over to Danny.
Good evening. Well, President Gibson Ray, Vice President Reed, Board Member Smith, Dickinson, and Navarro, and Superintendent Anello. I am Daniel Torres. For those of you who don't know, my official title is Supervisor - Site Safety and Emergency Preparedness. And I'll be highlighting the training conducted, ongoing training, and future training within the district in regard to emergency preparedness, site safety, and active shooter response. I thank Board Member Benson for requesting and Superintendent Anello for hosting a meeting to discuss the district's emergency management plan and site safety issues. Under Site Safety Assistant Training, we've conducted 3 staff development trainings for site safety assistants last August and October, and just recently this month. Some of the items we covered are supervisor's role and relationship, site safety role and responsibility, professionalism, dealing with difficult people, and a new AUSD site safety portal, which I am obviously running the prototype for. We also conducted our first iteration of the state mandated SB 1606 school security officer training with an in-house instructor, which I am. It's a money-saving effort. We don't have to pay an outside consultant to conduct the training. And it is, again, it's mandated for any site safety assistant or coordinator who works 20 hours or more at a site. That training consists of role and responsibility of school security officers, disasters and emergencies, law and liability, mediation, conflict resolution, and the dynamics of student behavior. We've also conducted student monitor training, also 3 days of staff development training, last August, this in October, and again this month. For student monitors, we've covered more than once the role and responsibility of the student monitors, because they do have a large contact in a 2-hour period in the cafeteria with a majority of the students on campus. We covered suspicious and dangerous individuals, situational awareness, interpersonal communication skills, and highlighting the positive, which is in conjunction with the PBIS. I've also conducted administrative assistant training last November. Covered the majority of the same thing, but we also included the ALIS response for an active shooter. Mm-hmm. We've also types of threats and responses with our hazards and emergency management plan. I've conducted emergency preparedness and site safety training at Mission Elementary School, where we covered emergency management, NIMS, ICS, suspicious and violent individuals, active shooter ALIS response, and we also did a practical exercise for a scenario where there was a possible missing student. We've also conducted site safety and violent intruder training at Prospect High School. We covered de-escalation techniques, situational awareness, and pre-attack indicators. Also just recently conducted training for the Transportation Department on safety and security awareness, specific to their role. Again, we've talked about special considerations for our special needs and special populations, de-escalation techniques, and active shooter response was covered with the Department of Homeland Security run, hide, fight, and also the shooter response specific to a bus incident. We also had a meeting with the secondary administrators where we covered site safety, personnel, role and responsibility, the relationship with STM, our contract security, and also we introduced STM management and field operations leadership. Ongoing training is the training for emergency management plan with site administrators and vice principals. Future training will be conducted the ALIS active shooter response, de-escalation techniques, site-specific requests, which come to administrators, emergency management plan, ICS, EOC functions. I'm also going to discuss exercises and videos.
One thing that we did highlight in the meeting with Brittany Vinson was the emergency preparedness day that we come up with a plan for. It's going to kind of mirror the great California shakeout. I'm going to try to incorporate that during the week of our youth violence prevention. And it'll be geared more towards site safety and emergency preparedness type things outside of an earthquake. And I believe now we will field any of your questions. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you for the report. I do know that state emergency officials are also in process of training, and they're doing something called CERT for neighborhoods. And the reason I wanted us to take a look at emergency plans as a district is because often schools are facilities that people go to. Sometimes we use them in emergencies, and so we need to be prepared. I want everyone, all of our staff, to feel competent to know that they can handle an emergency at our school sites. And oftentimes we're dealing with those soft issues. I feel that we're a district that's blessed and that we haven't had to deal with many traumatic situations. I think it's a blessing, but I do think that we also need to be ready. So thank you for the team for looking at this and for staying on top of this. And I appreciate that we're becoming more active with our drills to make sure our students can also be prepared. And I appreciate that we're looking at this, and thank you to the board for also having the presentation.
Thank you. Anyone else? Any questions, comments?
Okay. Thank you, both of you. Public presentations, we have none. Hearings, we have none. Action items, we have number one, disclosure ratification of the tentative agreement between Nanyak Unified School District, Nanyak Education Association for 2015-2016.
In front of the board this evening is a copy of the tentative agreement, the summary of the terms with our Nanyak Education Association. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank both teams, both Nanyak Education Association, I believe there are two representatives here, as well as the district team for working so diligently and late into the night to get this ratified. It's also, your packet also includes the disclosure to the County Office of Education, who has approved our tentative agreement, that we can afford to do this year and 2 years out. And I will let Mr. Strickler talk, but I believe Antioch Education Association did approve and ratify the contract as well. So I would ask the board to approve it this evening.
Thank you. Any questions and comments? With that, we do have two speakers. The first one is Mr. Strickler. 3 minutes on the clock.
No, I don't take that long.
2.5 minutes.
I always follow you.
Thank you. 70 is good.
Yes. And good evening again, board members. How's that? Nice short. The last time I forgot to introduce myself. I know you all know Robert Strickler, President of the Antioch Education Association. First of all, tonight I'd like to thank all members of both bargaining teams who worked diligently and, yes, long into the night to reach an agreement. Of course, not as long as the past, but that's actually a thank you to Jessica and the team now. I want to thank both Jessica and Essence, who isn't here, for working quickly on getting the new disability plan in place. It's been a goal of mine for the past 4 years, is to get a disability plan, a good one, standard disability insurance. Teachers don't have a disability insurance or SDI. We did have a plan, but it was not a very good plan. So now teachers will be covered. Bargaining is never an easy process, but both teams were respectful and listened to each other. There's still even occasionally laughed. We still need to work on issues surrounding special education, so we have agreed to form a task force, which was part of the agreement, to hopefully resolve many of those issues. Special education teachers are some of the positions that are getting harder and harder to fill. In fact, I noticed a few of them that were leaving right there on the report for later on. So we need to improve their working conditions so that we can keep them there and that they don't leave. And yes, the tentative agreement was approved by the members who wanted the ballots yesterday. We've had more ballots than ever turned in, over 500 in some. We usually don't get more than half, so that was really nice to know, and it was approved by more than 98%. So just wanted to thank you for that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Valerie Luke, you're on deck.
Hello, Valerie Luke. I am here representing the AEA negotiations team. And I'm also here, good evening to everyone. Also here to thank you. I particularly would like to thank the board for in and your guidance in your side of the negotiations this year. I think we had our ups and downs always at the table. That's the way it goes. But I think overall it was a very smooth year, and it was nice to be able to sit down and talk about the issues that we had and reach an agreement that our members are extremely happy with. I've had many thank yous coming in since the day that we reached our settlement on March 1st, and those thank yous are directed not only at our team, but at your team for understanding and appreciating the hard work that we do, and showing that with the compensation and other things that we were able to settle this year. So I'd like to thank all of you and thank Jessica and the AUSD team, because it, we're very grateful for the settlement that you will approve that tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. And from study that sits up here, it was very nice negotiations. You guys came, you were organized, you were polite. You know, you had solid convictions that it was easy to listen to. We didn't get yelled at, because sometimes when I get yelled at, I shut down. So I appreciate that. And I think it was the teams who were both good on both sides. So thank you very much. So this is an action item. What is the pleasure of the board?
I would move approval.
We have a motion by Mrs. Smith.
Second.
Second by Ms. Vinson. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Congratulations. Ms. Romano, you have item 2, Antioch Management Association, AMA Salary Schedule and Benefits Adjustment.
Yes, in front of the board this evening is a request or a recommendation that the salary schedules for AMA, which is our management team, they're not a bargaining unit, but they're a recognized group here in Antioch, and that the same 4% salary increase that is going to both AEA and by its Me Too clause to CSEA be approved as to AMA along with this, the adjustment to health and welfare benefits.
Thank you very much. Any comments or questions? The pleasure of the board.
Motion approved.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Rulick, second by Mrs. Smith. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0. We have the 2015-2016 second interim report, Mr. Leonard.
Good evening, governing board. Or I'm used to the governing board, so Board of Education, whatever your title is.
Hey, y'all.
First of all, I'd like to thank Stephanie for saving the second interim for my first week on the job.
grand design.
So anyway, it's my pleasure to present the board with the second interim report. The report measures, and first let me tell you a little bit about what's going on here, because it's different to all of you except for board member Navarro as far as how the presentation looks. So we removed a whole bunch of slides because frankly it doesn't really tell you what this report's about. The report is to measure the difference between your first interim, or between your adopted budget, your first interim, and your second interim. So this has reduced a whole bunch of pages, and it really focuses on the changes. The report also is a little different than what I'm used to. So when you look at what we call the state forms in your packet, the state forms have columns where it has your original budget, your board approved budget, your actuals to date, and your projected. And when I look at a first interim report or a second interim report, I always look at a column E that says, what's the difference? And the first thing I noticed was everything's zero, so we're perfect. No changes. So I talked to Mia, and I'll probably defer a few things to Mia if you have questions. What I'm used to seeing is the first interim report numbers in column B, and then our estimated numbers in column D, and then it gives you a difference. It's, I see you're looking for...
What tab?
Page 46.
Page
46.
Right.
That's fine, I changed this.
Right. So if you look at the state forms, you see all these columns, and the first part of it is your revenues and your expenditures. There's a summary. Column A is what you adopted back in June. Column B is the operating budget. And what is that actually in here is the operating budget as of the end of February. So it's not measuring anything. And so what we're doing tonight is on the PowerPoint presentation, we're showing you the difference actually from your adopt budget to the second interim. Normally it would be the second interim to the first interim, but we were moving quickly. Another note I'd like to make before we get to the presentation is when I was reviewing the budget with Mia, I noticed that there was a lot of things that we should be unencumbering. So encumbering, when you develop a budget and you have budgets in place, you encumber or hold in abeyance your salaries, for example. And so if we know that there's positions that are vacant and going to be vacant for the rest of the year, we need to unencumber that. So you're able to see what the budget is going to look like as we get closer and closer to estimated actuals. Mia did exactly as I asked her to. Please unencumber vacant positions. So she did unencumber the vacant positions, but what my direction should have been, please unencumber the vacant positions that won't be filled this year. So we ended up unencumbering all vacant positions. So this report is a little bit misleading, and we will come back to the board in your first meeting in May, because we have to report a budget revision on the salaries that you just approved, and then we'll re-encumbering those positions that were inadvertently, and it's a communication thing between me and I.
Thank you for correcting that, because I was really happy to see that number.
Yes.
I highlighted it. I thought,
yeah. Wow, this is good. So with that, they're going to be up there, or we don't?
Oh.
Okay.
Usually, communication issue. We didn't say bring it on a thumb drive, but don't worry, your staff is running.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
It's in the report, if you just go
yeah.
down the page.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay, just for
the
audience. Okay, so what, as you all know, that we, once your budget is adopted, we're required by law to bring a first interim report, which looks at your expenditures and your finances through October 31st. You have 45 days to report out, which that would normally happen in December. You have your second interim report that measures your activity through January 31st, and then we have 45 days to report out. So we're a tiny bit late, but we'll be on time in the next
step. We're late in December, so we're consistent. Can you go to page 32 on that? And now it'll bring up the
okay.
The
just for the audience.
This is Jeff's first time, it's
okay. Let's see, we're here.
32. In the whole packet.
So actually, we keep going out the other way.
You're on 26. You're getting there. 28.
Yes.
29.
You're there. Next, keep going. Keep going. Keep going. There we go.
There you go.
Oh,
it's
upside down. Okay, everybody just read this way. We can get it.
Okay. Yeah. I apologize. Getting used to.
There you go.
Oh, perfect.
Okay.
So let's go to the slide that says purpose. Yeah, okay, good introduction. Okay, so again, the purpose is to communicate the financial condition of the district to be sure that we're on target for getting through the end of this fiscal year. Also, I just want to remind the board, as Deborah said, wow, these numbers look great. This is second interim, so it's reporting through January 31st. It does not include the $4 million plus that you've approved in salaries and benefits tonight. Okay? Okay, so with that, you'll see on the general fund, next slide, and hopefully the numbers are small, but I can actually see those numbers from here. So I hope the audience can see them as well. So you see our revenue difference. So again, this is going from January 31st back to adopted budget. So we have local control funding formula, federal revenue, state revenue, and local and other revenues. And this is combined. So we will go, we'll go over the unrestricted and the restricted. But the change in the combined is $2.7 million increase. And certificate expenditures and other financing, you'll see that we have certificated classified benefits and everything that goes on the expenditure side of the budget. The negative actually means that that's we're saving that much money. But again, some of this has to be reinstated because we took out a little too much on vacancies. So the net change to the ending fund balance is $8.3 million. That's a great number. Except remember when the budget, when you we gave you a spreadsheet that shows the salaries, so this is actually $4 million less. But again, we wanted to show you some of the components of the ending fund balance, which is down below. So you have an ending fund balance of $18.89 million. We have our required designation, statutory designation for economic uncertainties, 3%, revolving cash reserved for restricted and categorical programs, supplemental and concentration dollars that are reserved, reserves for other designations, and then we have an unappropriated amount of $6.9 million. This is combined. Okay, next slide is unrestricted. So this breaks it down by your unrestricted dollars and your restricted dollars. So unrestricted changed by $4,441 or $461 to the positive. It shows negative in our expenditures, but that means there's savings when you see the negatives. And so net increase to the ending fund balance was $6,466. Looks good. We have notes on next page. What were the changes in our revenues? So our changes were non-public school adjustment, mandate. When the budget was adopted, we got one number from the state and school services. That number went down, so the revenue that we expected went down. Lottery increase, other state revenue increase, other local revenue increase. Mia, could you give an example of what other local revenue that was or increasing?
The other local revenues are...
Do you mind going to the mic? Right. Thank you.
Sure.
For unrestricted. I told her I'd throw over the ball once in a while, so I hope I didn't.
And he did. Good evening. The other local revenues are the insurance reimbursements. So we get reimbursed for those claims. And also we had Dow action lawsuit settlement, and we received about $130,000 for that, and also the medical billing of about $140,000 that we received. So we only recognize the revenue as we received actual cash, so they are not part of the adopted budget.
Okay. I wouldn't leave yet.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. So, so then we have contributions to routine and restricted maintenance, contributions to the special ed program and after-school program. So we have the change to the ending fund balance and unrestricted $6.4 million. Again, we're measuring from second interim all the way back to your adopted budget. Restricted funds, That's a big number, $2.7 million in revenue increases. Actually, the no savings and or savings were offset and increases in books and supplies and expenditures here. Net increase to the restricted fund balance, $1.7 million. And we have our reserves, and the reserves for categorical balances, I believe, are in our notes. So if we would go to the next slide. So the revenue, with the federal revenue, it's always uncertain. And it usually, what I see, if you expect $100,000, you're going to get $75,000. We have the Prop 39 monies that came in, and this is part of what would be restricted, the numbers that we saw on the previous page. Mm-hmm. Prop 39, everybody familiar with that? Okay. So other local revenue, Microsoft settlement agreement or settlement, we got less than we anticipated.
No, actually,
okay. Okay, I'll explain that one. So what happened is that that's a reimbursement account, and we only recognize expenses. We ordered some computers that we did not receive after June 30th, so we recognized the expense in 15-16. So when we recognized the expense, we got reimbursed in 15-16. So it was recognized in 15-16 for the revenue as well.
Okay, thanks. I knew I needed you, Mia.
Oh.
So revenues increased by $2.7 million. Expenditures, savings of $1.6 million. And then you see, again, our contributions to the other programs. So change in fund balance in the restricted side of the budget, $1.7 million. So we have to demonstrate that you can afford to keep staying in business for the next two fiscal years. So we have a combined multi-year projection. And so you see our revenues. This is based on projections that we work through School Services California and the Department of Finance, and those will change as we get closer to developing the budget for 16-17. Expenditures, this includes salary increases. We met with the AEA to go over this with them on last Friday, and the question was on employee benefits, why is that going up so dramatically? What's going on? That is the STIRS and PERS increases for per law to offset the doom and gloom in those two retirement systems. So the governor gives us the money on the one hand and takes away on another hand. Let's see. So again, when you look at the ending fund balance, it looks terrific, but again, it does not include the $4 million. So when you take the $4 million, it goes in the 15-16 year, the 16-17 year, the 17-18 year, all of a sudden, $12 million is gone. I would remind the board that there's three ways you can approach certification. You can be a positive district, you can be a qualified district, which says we might not be able to meet all of our financials for the next two fiscal years, or we could be a negative district, which that's a disaster. We don't want to ever go there. So staff is saying that this district will be able to meet its financial obligations for the next current and two subsequent fiscal years. And staff is also recommending that the governing board approve the second interim report, and we're open to questions. And when you approve the report, I always have to say this, you're not approving the presentation, you're approving the state forms.
Any questions, comments?
Should I add you before we did the vote on the contract now?
No, we still have enough money.
Well, we have enough time to work on budget development, and it's been a pleasure working with Jessica. She's the most conservative HR person I've ever met. You're in good hands with HR, which represents about 86% of the budget.
Thank you. So thank you for explaining the vacant positions, because as you see, I had highlighted and
yes.
had questions about that. So thank you. Let's see. Now, the only other thing I was looking at are the expenditures. And so if you don't know the answer to this right now, it's okay. I'm wondering if we have allocated any funds for emergency preparedness, just out of curiosity.
Mia?
I would say that there is a budget for there's a safety budget for Angela High School and the Valley High School. We allocated the security budget for that, but not for the emergency preparedness.
Okay. That's a good question. So it might be something we want to consider in budget development.
That is absolutely correct. We need to consider it. We're really going to be prepared. I really don't want teachers buying supplies out of their pockets. So we're really going to have to rethink and look at this and see what we can do to make sure we're providing resources to be prepared.
Great.
Any other comments? With that, is there a motion?
Move approval.
We have a motion by Mrs. Smith.
Second.
Second by Ms. Vincent. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank the staff, me and her staff, for doing such a terrific job.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're at consent calendar. We have the always changes to HR certificated and classified. And then it looks like there's another change. That's a different one. Okay. So anybody have any consent items they want to pull?
I do.
Okay.
I would like to pull item 16-1 G, H, I.
Wait. 16 what?
16-1
okay. mm-hmm.
G, H, I, J, and L.
And do you want to pull them and...
I'm going to ask that those get moved. We're working currently on how to be more transparent with what go out to bid so that we're not asking the Board of Education to award a bid when they have not established it as a priority. So I know that Mr. Learned has also been in facilities operations and has some processes that they've used in other districts that I think would lend themselves to more transparency. These particular projects, while all of them valuable, we really have to sit down and assess whether or not these are the immediate needs that we need to address. I am leaving on two of the items that are award bid because we view them as a serious safety consideration that needs to be addressed immediately. I can't really wait for that particular process.
My concern on this was there was no contract attached to it. So how do...
Right. So that's part of what we're going to do. I requested this morning that we put an item on your May 20th agenda where we would provide a facilities report to the board, which would share with you how the contract is included. Getting a contract for construction is a lot different than a RFP for request for services. And so and one of the processes we'd like to introduce to this board is instead of you just seeing award a bid, that you actually get, we get the authorization from you to actually bid the project.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the first thing. And then, but when the project is bid for a contractor, you have your what's called your front-end specifications, where it's all the stuff that this young lady loves, legal boilerplate. It also includes the what's called the agreement in the contract. So one of the things that we would do is share with the board during that meeting the front end specs. I know that it was reviewed by legal counsel as to form. Legal counsel I've used before is very competent. So this particular agreement is used in all of your construction products. So I think once we have that special board or presentation to the board on facilities, I'm confident that your agreement and question will be answered because it's used in every one of your contracts.
So in this particular case, when you award the bid, you're not signing the document. So that...
Okay, so when the bid is awarded, the board is now giving staff authorization to enter into the contract with the contractor. So once it's awarded at this body, it's a done deal.
Okay. I guess it still doesn't answer my question. If we haven't seen the, if we, the board, did not approve the process to go out for the two that you want to keep in.
Correct.
And we're agreeing to the award, we haven't seen the details that...
Of what?
Yeah.
Yeah, so what the project is.
So I would have to rely on...
Well...
You saying we should do this.
So. Okay, I understand. So I did review the projects. I did talk to Jeff. I have spoken with Tim. These projects, so I can say with absolute confidence, one project that we're not pulling from the agenda is Deer Valley Stadium Field. It needs to be done. The contractor is a very qualified contractor. Cleary Brothers, we've used them in that other district that I used to be at. I asked about the project that was for slurry coating. It's a good price. I believe it's maybe eight schools or so, where could we hold off on it? And it's enough of a concern that it was pushed forward through maintenance to get it done so we don't have any claims, worker comp, or liabilities, property claims. So I feel very confident in recommending that you leave those two items on and let us come back to you on the other items. I don't think you're going to have to rebid them, but what I do know is you don't have enough information.
Right.
And so we're going to give you the information. When we do a request to call for bids, that includes the project, the scope of the project, the budget of the project. As I was reading these write-ups, it said it's within the budget. I'm like, okay, so what was the budget? So I understand. And I just would request that you have confidence in me for this one time.
And I just bet you win.
I know. But I do bring an enormous amount of experience in facilities. I have a lot of experience in that.
And I don't doubt that. I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
Deborah, you had a question?
So, yeah, I'd like to know if this, all of this work that has to be done, would the district benefit from a project labor agreement? Just out of curiosity, because we're trying to save money. Yeah. We're trying to make sure that things are efficient.
Right. So project labor agreements, in my humble opinion, can cost the district more because you're being forced into union-only work. And sometimes, and the PLO folks will sometimes argue that...
We're a union district. You didn't know that.
Yes, and so was Alani's. But we didn't have it. I'm not saying it doesn't work, but for construction projects, sometimes you end up paying more under the PLO if you open it up. You're limiting your pool of contractors. I knew this was going to be a tough one when you asked that question.
Well, I just want to make sure that, number one, we're, you know, considering, because you know those agreements hire people from within this community. Mm-hmm. And so it's all about safety, getting it done right the first time.
Right.
I do know that when you work with unions, that work is guaranteed, pretty much, you know, because they're all highly skilled.
Okay.
So we don't want to keep doing things over. We seem to waste a lot of money. doing things over and over again, and we need to make sure we get it right.
Okay.
Thank you. Anyway. Just for the record, I'm okay with you hiring non-union workers, because I also have experience with people who are non-union workers, mm-hmm. who are highly skilled craftsmen. So yes. Just so you hear the other end of the story, I'm okay with not having a PLA in place.
I'm really excited to be here tonight. I second that.
Not political at all.
On yeah. PLAs, we have one for the bond for Antioch High Schools, $46 million, whatever.
Yes, so I've heard that.
That's good. Yeah. But these are smaller jobs.
They're very small. I looked at a project that you approved, I believe, in February. This is for Antioch High School for 49 air conditioning units. You got a heck of a price on that. You got it was $550,000. You're paying about $11,000 per unit, and that I don't know if it's.
I hope they didn't work in this building because everybody's fanning in here.
Well, I was just going to ask. I was going to ask Jeff if this was one of the buildings that's supposed to get an upgrade on its energy management, because.
No, we don't get air conditioning until April.
I understand, but I'm just saying.
No, I agree.
Anyway.
And just as a heads up, because I just learned this yesterday, that the project at Antioch High School is going to happen on Monday. And the way it's going to happen is there's going to be a helicopter on site lifting 49 units and setting them on the building. So this is a heads up. If you get a phone call saying, well, what's going on? That's what's going on at Antioch. Did I say Alkalani's or?
I'm
so sorry.
Any other
Antioch
support?
High School.
Any other comments or questions?
I have 16
what?
16-2, A through B, just for comments.
Why don't you just comment?
Okay, good. Are we there?
Well, I asked, would you want to put a consent calendar, so.
Great. So first, I'd like to appreciate Ruth Rubikova for resubmitting this contract with all of the information needed. The resumes and the outline of the services to be provided. And then I did want to ask a question. I see that we're supplying all of the mental health staff and all of the computers. Is that correct? Just want to make sure we can sustain all of this.
Good evening, board members. That is correct.
So I think this is a very thorough contract. It looks much different than the one we received from Tobin World. So because I've looked at this and had meetings with you, I'm going to recommend that we approve all of these contracts.
For your work. Dr. Stevenson, I'd like to thank you very much just for your direction and for your guidance, and also with your very thorough questioning, which actually helps us to ensure that we are accountable to students. So it's very much appreciated.
Thank you.
Any other items to this last report? See, so making the announcement.
This is one final note. Our hope is that we don't rebid these three projects that were pulled tonight. We're going to bring more information and ask the board to approve and on your April 20th board meeting.
Okay. And I do appreciate that. And I do value your experience. And
thank you.
So
thank you.
With that, only items 16, G, H, I, J, and L. We have no public comments, correct? Is there, what's the pleasure of the board for the consent calendar?
Move approval for the consent calendar second. Minus those items you just listed and with the corrected addendum on the dais.
We have a motion by Mrs. Smith, second by Ms. Vinson. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes 5-0. Okay, with that, sorry, give me a second. We have a board member vacancy protocols and procedures. I asked to have this gone, or do you want to explain it?
Well, yes. We need to, those of you who arrived late this evening, Trustee Smith did announce that this would be her last board meeting. And so.
Sorry, Willie. I'll miss you.
There is a need to appoint her replacement, given that. The law says that you can't be if it's longer than a four-month vacancy, you have to fill it. And so the discussion tonight is what process the Board of Education would like to use to fill the vacancy.
So if we go to vote, it costs many thousands of dollars. Yeah. So I would recommend not. Go to the appointment process. We do that the way we did with Mr. Bartle.
Yeah, he can tell us how torturous it was.
So what is the pleasure of the board? If we do go to that process, I would like to reevaluate the questions and ask different questions.
Definitely. I agree. I definitely think you should reevaluate the questions. One comment that I did have from someone in the public was in the tallying of the votes, and you guys might want to consider this, is instead of just everybody reading out their vote, you mark it, you pass down to Stephanie or Nancy or somebody, and they then announce.
I like that.
Candidate A had three, candidate B had four. That kind
especially
of thing.
Being on the last one, it was awkward. So, yeah, no, I like that.
Okay.
So with that, a nod, collective nod, that we move forward with the amendment process, and you will develop a calendar and timeline for us?
Correct.
Thank
you. Okay. Thank you.
Well, that was easy.
That was easy.
See you, Claire.
Don't leave the door hit you on the left.
All right. You want to go now? We don't need. We got a forum.
Thanks a lot, Diane. You just picked your hand real low, aren't you?
So with that, we'll go to items for discussion by the board, school reconfiguration.
Yes, as you'll recall, we spoke at the last board meeting about exploring the idea of keeping sixth grade students from Carmen Dragon, Jack London, and Grant Elementary, the feeder schools to Black Diamond, keeping them currently at those three schools as sixth graders. The schools were built in about around 20, 25 years ago, and if you do the math, you can see that that's when the young families were here, those children have grown up, and so they've aged out without quickly replacing with younger children. So we the direction from the board last time was to hold some parent meetings, because as you'll recall, we had met with the staff of all four schools to get kind of what they thought would be some strengths of the proposal and maybe some questions or concerns about it. And I want to thank Chris Williams and her team. They held several meetings with parents and in a very short time compiled lists of questions, tried to answer as much, got them back to the school, and I'm actually going to ask her to kind of report what feedback in general she received from the parent group.
So I've put at each of your places, there's a compilation of the parents.
Is there copies out there in case they want them?
There are not. I am sorry. Can we
get copies made? Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica.
We sent out a notification about a week and a half ago to all the parents indicating that on Tuesday night and Tuesday morning yesterday that we would be holding parent meetings. We held a morning meeting at 9 o'clock at Emno Grant Elementary, and we held an evening meeting last night at Carmen Dragon. And I will tell you that I was really appreciative of the parent comments and their the way they handled themselves. The principals were wonderful in the organization that were there. Bob was there, as well as Jason Larson and Winnie Duffy from the district. And we presented the information much as we did to the teachers, in that this was a proposal that was coming from the district to the board, that it was being done, as Stephanie indicated to you, because of the aging community, the change in population, the decrease we were seeing, but also as an opportunity to bring sixth grade back into the elementary because we now have space. And we asked from our parent community, unlike our teachers, we asked teachers to identify the strengths and the concerns that they thought both the students, parents, as well as staff would have. With the parent community, we asked for their students, from their students' point of view, as well as from their point of view, what they felt the strengths and concerns might be, as well as any questions or suggestions they may have. We finished last night about 8 o'clock. This morning, my staff quickly compiled all the documents and typed them up. And then in between meetings today, I started grouping a lot of the questions because I felt that there was a lot of repetition that was happening because we put the families or the parents into groups of somewhere between 4 and 5, sometimes 6 parents, and they got to talk amongst themselves and then write their information down. There was also question and answer during those sessions. And so I started looking through and realized that there were patterns that I was seeing in the types of questions they were asking and try to respond to that. This document, I was hoping to have gotten out around noon today, didn't go out until around 4 o'clock this afternoon, and the principals pushed it out to all of their parent communities. And so the parents, these schools, whether they attended or not, received this document. So I'm hoping that will help them, you know, kind of see what was going on at the meetings. The first meeting we held was an open forum, and you can see at the top we had approximately 44 parents. At least our sign-ins were 44. I think there might have been a few more than that that didn't sign in toward the end. And what we found in that forum was that we had 2 or 3 fairly vocal parents that monopolized a part of the meeting during the question and answer, or felt like they wanted to make their statements, and that some of the parents afterwards expressed that they felt a little bit intimidated talking out. And so the evening presentation we did a little differently. As people came in, we put them in groups and took them, the leader would take them off to one of the classrooms, and they were in groups of about 12 to 15. Probably got up to 20. We counted all the children that were coming along. But I think they felt much more comfortable being able to talk openly. But there were some parents that were concerned that they didn't have this open forum. And they kept saying, are we all coming back again? So, you know, and for some, I think they wanted the audience. And for some, I think they just wanted to hear the information. So that's why I said to a few parents, I will send out all the comments from all the groups so you're hearing it. Even though I had read the comments from the morning and realized they're pretty similar as we keep going along. So as you read through this, I think for a lot of the parents, what we're seeing is a real positive response to keeping the sixth grade back at the elementary school. The concerns that we're hearing when there were in the list of concerns are more around maybe some process kinds of things of the timeline and that, but more it's around what's the curriculum going to look like? Will my child have the same experience of moving around with teachers? Will my child be able to have some electives? You know, how different is it going to look than what they're currently having in fifth grade? I was able to talk to 2 or 3 of the students, the sixth grade students that were there last evening, and a couple of them were really excited about moving on into middle school. And so they were, when I said, well, if you did stay, what would you want to see different? And they said, well, do we have to go to the assemblies with the kindergarten and first grade students? You know, I mean, they want to feel like the big kids, you know. And so I think in working with the principals, trying to find a way where students felt like they were separated out somehow, they had some, you know, different look to what their program looked like, is going to be the work that's ahead of us should the board suggest we move on with this process. A lot of concerns as you read through some of this. Some of them weren't captured on paper, although there were some verbal comments just about, well, what is happening with Black Diamond? You know, what are we going to do with that school? And how, if my child moves into there for seventh grade, what will look different? And so, you know, our kind of a promise to them, which should this happen, we have a year to begin working on this. We'll continue to work with the principal and the staff at that school to really beef up the program, not only for the students that are there now, but for when their students move forward as well. So, I bring this to you for discussion. I know that there are a few parents here that were there last night. I really appreciate their coming tonight. We told all the parents that you would be having this discussion tonight. And
I'd like to add one thing before you start. When we discussed in cabinet today, after Chris brought back the information and shared that, you know, although there were some concerns, if you make a general statement, the parents were very positive about the about the proposal. However, you did have some that really want their children to have that middle school experience. Yes, one thing we'd like the board to consider is that we send out to all of those families a questionnaire, and if we get enough interest in sixth grade, we go ahead and open a class or two at Black Diamond, if numbers allow for that. That's one possibility.
So you're saying they'd stay there or they could go to sixth grade?
So. If there's enough interest. So if there's 15, that's obviously not enough to open a classroom. But if there's 30 or 60, that's two classrooms. It might be a nice transition to consider.
Have you considered Survey Monkey? Because coming down to talk and, I mean, it's no, I would.
No, we would send something in the mail that we to send back.
Oh. Okay.
Send it home with the kids. Or just send it home in the backpack.
Come to a community meeting.
Yeah, no, we weren't talking about another community meeting.
Okay. What's going to be the reaction of the teachers?
Good. The teachers, did I not give you the response to the teachers before?
I don't see it.
That was 2 weeks ago. I will get that back to you as well. I would say that it's mixed. It depends on the staff that you were talking to, and again, we kind of divide ourselves up on one day about 3 weeks ago, and each of us went out to a different school at the same time on a staff meeting. And I happened to be at Carmen Dragon, and I would say mine was fairly positive. There's still a lot of concerns, and some of the concerns were coming from primary teachers worried about these big kids on the campus. There were several fifth grade teachers that I worked with that were very supportive of those, because they're seeing their children in their classrooms that maybe needed one more year before they went off to the middle school, and thought that that would help prepare them. So, I would say a lot of the things that the parents were responding to, we probably had some of that from, the same balance kind of from teachers that were coming back out to us. A lot of it was programmatic. The specialists were, how are these kids going to, we're going to need more PE. We're going to have these kids on the campus. We're going to need more resource teacher time. We're going to need, so those are all things that we would need to work through, working with Jessica and through staffing and allocations. Safety actually became an issue from all groups. I will say that that came up, that there was this concern that they think that there's campus safety now at the middle schools, and are we going to provide campus safety at the elementary? And I haven't been here long enough to know if that should be a concern or not, but I just will tell you that it did come up from pretty much every site. Somebody raised that as an issue with having these big kids that were going to stay on the campus. And we had to kind of keep reminding them, they're the kids you have now. We aren't sending a bunch of kids to you.
There are a lot of questions about Orchard Park and what their experience has been.
Not a lot. Not a lot. In fact, I'd say we brought it up more than anybody else did. Yeah, and in talking with them, we said we already have a K-8 in this district. It's functioning extremely well. I think class size came up with teachers as well as with the parents. And again, we've talked about it's a negotiated item, and that Jessica will work with Robert and his team as we go through this to try to figure out what does it look like to just bring a sixth grade rather than a 6, 7, 8 back onto a campus. I mean, my suggestion is if we were to move forward, I think that it would be good to bring both those sixth grade teachers at Black Diamond together with the fifth grade teachers at the three elementaries and have them come together to talk about what this program look like. Because, in my perception, hearing a lot of the teachers as well as a lot of the parents, I think there's a lot of misconception of how different, of what sixth grade really is, and that there's a feeling, I think, that it is so significantly different than what a fifth grade class might be, that I think many people would be surprised to see that it was significant is what they think. The experience that they are all worried about is, will my children be prepared to move classes? So if they were going to do it at sixth grade, they didn't want the teacher moving between students. They wanted their kids to experience the moving you know, among things, as to prepare them for 7th and 8th grade. So there's perceptions of staff and the parents of what, and students too, of what it's going to be like when they go to 6th grade.
Question to you. Our nearest neighbor is, who's got a model of this?
Oh, I do not.
I know Alcor Grove does, because I checked them, and they were all district by 4 years ago, and they're they are in a case that's for the 7th and 8th middle school, and there are other districts I can't.
West County did do a couple of their schools where they went K-6 a few years ago, so I believe they still have some as well.
And I know we've talked back and forth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
we talked it in San Ramon too for a while. We never ended up doing it, but we were looking at declining schools, and we considered that as a model as well.
And there's some misinformation out there that we went to the K-5 because it was somehow a better programmatically. Well, the reason this district went to from K-6 was because we didn't have any space.
It was numbers.
It was booming. It was completely numbers. And everyone started reading the book, Taking Center Stage, and you know,
caught in the middle.
Sorry, now it's taking center stage, you know, which hasn't really borne, not a lot of fruit from that tree.
We also moved sixth graders back for a time because of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And then we put them back out again. So the sixth graders have kind of been like,
they are the caught in the middle group.
Bounce. They are in the middle. Where is it? Orchard Park. You don't have to be bounced. You just... Mm-hmm. Stay right.
Well, and you will see that there are several parents that, you know, several groups, I should say, not just individual parents, but several groups that ask, can we create some K-8 schools? So
question, as a child, a product of K-8 myself, I see that there was some interest in K-8. How big an impact was that? Was it just fringe, or was there a lot of interest in possibly?
There's a lot of people talking about that, the concept, and they do understand how Orchard Park functions. Are we looking at, and I think the board has expressed their wish to look at a K-8 model on the other side of town at some point. And I think there are a lot of parents that would thrive, and kids would thrive in that model. So it is something that I think we will be looking at the pleasure of the board, and I think the board has expressed that interest too.
As far as these three schools, I don't believe there's space to do a K-8 on those campuses right now.
Not at this time.
So I was just reading through these, and there's two of them that kind of struck me as kind of special. These kids are not just thinking about their own little worlds, but this one wrote, I really want to stay here because I love the teachers here, and I think they should put sixth grade in this elementary school. Please and thank you.
How cute is that?
She's just assuming we're going to do it and thanking us already.
I don't like that positive. And the other one is, we would like our special kids to stay in this school. They are used to it and they are more fragile.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very thoughtful student who's thinking about somebody besides themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's very special with our kids.
Mm-hmm.
No, they were wonderful meetings, I will tell you. I really enjoyed meeting the parents and hearing their opinion.
Deborah?
So I did hear from some teachers that they like the idea, but it feels rushed, and they would like to have more planning around it so that families can plan, because I think there was some discussion about parent schedules in the evening, how kids are going to, you know, this whole discussion about kids having to walk home differently if they're moved to a different school. So safety concerns were definitely out there. The other thing is, I heard from parents that don't want their students that have special needs to be moved. They want them to stay. They feel it would be more problematic for those students to be moved from their present location or wherever they were. So I do like this idea, and in terms of site safety, I think we had enough issues in and around our community, you know, with people hanging around the schools, parents, you know, not leaving the school sites, to have more site safety at some of the elementary schools. It's just a future consideration. We don't have to decide that. I never recommend, like, another school district I know that put $3 million into a site safety budget, you know, with all of the SROs and all. So I would never recommend that. But I do think that if we were to, you know, consider this, that we think about the planning, that we do involve the teachers, and that we give the teachers the space to be honest so that they don't feel like they're going to be retaliated against, I think, well, you know, that's kind of what I hear in the air. So I really think we need to create safe space for teachers to be able to talk about this, because they also want what's best for the district.
Well, to be transparent, my oldest, she's in fourth grade at Carmen Dragon, Miss Boudet's class. And he said, Dad, you're going to talk about that today, right? You're going to talk about that, right? And so she's stoked about the possibility of staying at Carmen Dragon.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know I like it.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
I'm a huge fan of the K-8 model.
So maybe I'm not understanding this. There was less than 100 people that that participated?
There's only going to be 160 that would going to. That's how small the population is.
Okay. So that's a pretty good number, then.
Yeah.
We felt very happy with the number.
I didn't know what the number was. I was thinking it was 300, 400. Okay.
Though I certainly respect the idea of taking it, you know, very deliberately, I would opt towards striking when the iron is hot. I think we can. I think we should take some bold actions and do so.
And we do have a public comment now, Julia. And Kulin?
Megukwe.
Megukwe.
Okay, I can do that.
Okay, just call Julia.
Julia.
Good evening, members of the board and members of the community. My name is Julia Negroque. I'm the mother of children that attend the public schools in Minnewanka. I want to let you know that the community is happy to know that middle school grades are added to some elementary schools. Thank you, and please and thank you. For this reason, I, as a mother, a member of this community, my city, want to ask the board to please provide classrooms that have no more than 15 students per class, for each classroom to have a teacher in a class 8, a school hours that run from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., more school monitors, more creative and athletic programs, total power given to teachers to design their own class programs and tests. 10 minutes of mandatory break to be given to students for every 20 minutes of lecture. Very limited computer programs that offer blue light blocking glasses to each student. And this because electronic technology exposure in underdeveloped children scientifically causes brain cancers and blindness. And the programs that enrich the social and moral aspects of every student. Please, let me remind you that the things I'm asking you to provide to every school on behalf of my community are based on the fact that our teachers and students are the hardest working individuals in the whole world. That we are the richest country in the world, that we can make every student successful and well behaved. If we could invest more in education, because education is the best investment a society can make. And I'm basing all of these opinions following the model of most European countries that have all the students have grade of A pluses. Their behaviors are very rational, very human, very respectful, very kind to each other. We can achieve this in the United States. And what they do is every time they think that after 20 minutes of lecture, all children automatically go outside, whether it's snow, they breathe air, they talk with the other friend, they relax the muscles. This is just me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for being a patient. Joshua Klee.
He spoke.
No, he had another one for 17, too. Okay. Keisha Adams.
Good evening. I actually didn't know exactly
how to approach the board this evening. I'm one of the parents that attended the meeting yesterday evening at Carmen Dragon. And I'm actually one of the parents that is for the idea. I think it's great. It actually did a lot for me because I can say I was a product of a child that came through K-6 and moved on. I believe in my 31 years as being a parent and being a part of different and various school districts from Contra Costa County, Alameda County, and even Solano County, the benefit of being able to understand the adolescence of our children and how they grow. A lot of times they're not ready. I believe we need to offer more training for our teachers. The parents are concerned about how they transition, but the thing is, even if they left at fifth grade, they're still not trained to go into sixth grade. If we think about visiting our schools and understanding if our sixth graders attend Black Diamond next year, they don't even have a locker. But they have to carry the same amount of books and materials as the other children, which brings on a different form of stress and pressure to them as well. I believe in terms of how they're able to advocate with one another at that age is not appropriate. Again, they're not ready. They're not prepared. Most of them are still afraid of how they're going to transition. And that's one of the things that we don't offer in our schools is that readiness thing. I remember coming up, you know, basically in the 70s, and we did those visits like they do for college kids. When they're coming out of high school, they take a visit, and you get to walk the campus, and you get to get a feel of what you're going to embark on into your next fiscal year. And that's part of where that is not happening. I say that my child is Antoinette Adams. She's over at Jack London Elementary. And the biggest thing for me as a parent is the fact that I have basically been advocating for the past 3 years to involve myself, not just with parents, but children. It's not just about Antoinette. It's about every child that walks on that campus that I embrace every morning. I take the time out that God has given me to allow me to interact this way. I've had parents to approach me and ask me questions that I couldn't answer because I also wasn't being a voice to be able to come here to understand exactly how this works. So given that and the opportunity to do this tonight, hopefully we will appreciate what all of us need for our children and actually move forward to say that I believe leaving our children at these elementary schools would work, but I mean district-wide, not just for those three schools.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I guess
we're looking for a nod.
I guess we're looking for a nod from the board that we move forward. From board members, so I'm seeing no nod.
I'm saying yes.
I wish I had more time, but I'll nod.
Okay.
But I would like to look at the K-8.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's noted. Thank
this
you.
This is like a step toward the K-8.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah,
it's a nod from me, but I do really want to hear what the teachers have to say. So if you have that report, mm-hmm. I appreciate it.
I will send it to you. Definitely.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Okay, thank you. Resolutions for first reading, none. Resolutions for immediate action, unless you want to discuss them. Is there a motion?
There is a revision in front of the board on this.
That was the other one.
Resolution.
Oh, that I saw. No.
Oh, yes.
I mentioned that in the consent calendar.
Yeah.
But it is up there. It's just changing the number on it.
Well, there's two changes. One is the resolution number on page one.
Mm-hmm.
The second under the resolution, there had been two positions on here. One had gone vacant, so I did not redo the total FTE. So there is actually only one position that will be a part of this classified layoff.
Thank you.
I'll make a motion for that revision.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Resolutions for second reading action then. Board policies for first readings. Any questions? Board policies for second reading and action. We have two policies. Any questions or is there an action?
So,
there's a question.
I'm looking at on page 793, board policy 514.2. I'll get it right. So item number 8 on that page, it says every 3 years the program shall review its after-school program plan, including program goals, program content, and outcome measures.
Oh, you're on the first reading. Sorry. I didn't get that.
You didn't get it?
No, I thought nobody had any questions. Go ahead.
So anyway, every 3 years seemed like it's too far out. I think these programs need to be evaluated every year.
We actually are happy to provide the annual report that we have to provide to the state, which has metrics for the board to review.
Okay.
In addition.
Thanks.
It's just what law requires the 3 to 5 years to come back
anytime. Right, but for what we're requiring for our students, which is, you know, making sure we're meeting their needs, mm-hmm. making sure we're within the LCFF guidelines and evaluating programs. So if they're not effective, we're not spending money in those programs. Thank you.
Okay. Board policies for second reading and action. We have 2 policies, number 1 and 2. Are there questions?
So that's on petty cash. Any questions? I didn't actually read that, so no.
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Information anticipation of future action. We have nothing. Information items for general information. Do we have any questions on number 1 through 5?
Do we actually keep a petty cash fund?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm a little surprised that we keep a petty cash fund. I thought they were obsolete. Okay.
I haven't actually seen it, but I never thought of it.
I'm a little surprised. I thought they were obsolete.
There's an option over petty cash where some districts, like that other district I used to work at, we didn't like the cash at the schools, so we actually set up each school with basically a bank account with an ATM card. And at first there was kickback because they liked having that cash available, but when they learned that they could, like a high school, have $5,000 worth of expenditures that was refunded every, you know, when they drew down the account. So I think if it's something, the will of the board, we could revisit that AR and perhaps bring it back at a future date.
So it'd be electronic petty cash.
Yeah, it's basically, but you don't have cash on your school.
Right. No, I'm just being and
less petty.
Right.
Sorry.
So, any questions other than petty cash? Okay. Future agenda items from board members. Anybody? Okay, individuals to, okay, that didn't happen. Reports from board members relative to membership, other organizations, or district business. Anyone?
So, just wanted to share this and say that I was at Science Fair, as John Crowder mentioned all day, but we didn't get to find out what students were there until the next day. And then I was very surprised and happy to see we had so many students enter from our district. So I really appreciate the teachers and the teachers from both Deer Valley High and Antioch High School that entered our students. And that would be Jeff Atkins. And I'm going to pass this around so you all can see this, to see the students that participated. And the other thing that I was noting is that the middle schools are the ones that took the national prizes. The middle schoolers were more advanced than the high schoolers, and that caught all of us judges by surprise, because we just knew, you know, last year high school, you're going to just really do a really excellent job. No, it was the middle schoolers, and we were just thinking, wouldn't it be something if we really engaged our middle school students in science, math, and engineering so that they could participate. So, and it was Rick Barton. So I'll pass this down so you all can see that. The other thing is I went to an education, early childhood education forum, And I know we have TK here. It was awesome to listen to the teachers talk about the classroom experience and really advocating that we focus on early childhood education in our public schools and give more weight to that. And I went to the Dojo Libby open house. That was a lot of fun. And it was amazing to see so many parents out. Packed and engaging. I think Mr. Burgerhaus had to cut the lights off to get people to leave campus, so that was really exciting.
I'd like to also mention last Monday on 314 Pi Day, I went with Deborah over to John Crowder's after-school math program, and I was very surprised at the age of the young kids that were there with the big kids. But most important was looking at the numbers that they were, the notes that they were taking about how these kids were coming in math and just exploding in percentages. So it's an awesome program, something to keep on our radar to look into. But that was very eye-opening.
I attended a Educating for Careers conference in Sacramento. There's hundreds and hundreds of workshops. It's amazing. It's all about career tech and academies and just the explosion. California has a $4 billion budgeted now for this program. So this has really come a long way. And a lot of great workshops. One of the most interesting was this idea kind of segues in with tonight's discussion about the transitions from elementary to middle, from middle to high school, and all the kids that got kind of lost in the shuffle there. And so one school talked about their summer bridge program, with a 2-week program for incoming freshmen, and orient them to what life is like, what happens if you're a poor little ninth grade girl and get hit on by some senior and happen. So it's a lot of good practical education for these kids about just what high school is going to be all about. And another neat thing they did was they have rallies in which the seniors rally and they all get together in an auditorium and one by one stand up and I'm going to, and they say what college or career they're going to or to the military, and just gets a great response to see everybody, what you're kind of hearing, but you can actually see the kids announcing where they're going. So that sounds like a great motivational tool.
So if I ever get bored on a weeknight in our future, we're going to go to the school district in which we will be residing, and I'm not going to tell them that I've had 21 years on a board. Can you see where I'm going with this?
Yeah.
I'm going to have a lot of fun. I'm going to be like I was before I was on the board and I sat in that back seat. Yeah, Chris remembers. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's your last report.
Yep.
Hasta luego. Hasta luego. Thank you. So future board meetings of education for the four of us remain will be April 20th, May 11th, and May 25th. And I would like to dedicate this meeting to you.
Thank you. Move approval.
Wait. Cross my little thing.
Wait.
Okay. Is there a motion?
Yes. Move for adjournment.
There's a motion by Mrs. Smith.
I second it.
Second by Mr. Navarro. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Okay.